Kia ora ana, welcome to this Tangata Pasifika special. Over these next few weeks, we're sharing amazing stories from our online archive.
For this episode, we'll be taking a look at our Pacific community and its leaders. But coming up, we revisit the Dawn Raid's apology. What were the thoughts of our people on the event?
But first, a historic 2021 election for the proud nation of Samoa. The Samoan community shared their thoughts before the election results.
Of course, very happy. You know, in terms of the substance of the matter, you know, an election that gave us 26 seats, even with the court challenges, being very sure of the merits of our arguments, I think, you know, I believe that we would get to this place. It just took longer than we expected.
At any time, did you have any doubts that your party could win the decisive caucus?
No. Not if, we firmly believed in terms of the merits of our arguments per se. So, having said that, of course it was the court's decision. And because we've always advocated the rule of law, had the court not, you know, come down, then we would have accepted.
So what's it like being the Samoa's first woman prime minister and for the Pacific?
Well, I'm very excited, you know, to have an opportunity to be in this position. I'm very excited for my colleagues in the FAS party. You know, we've journeyed together. Although it's been a relatively short journey if you compare it, you know, to normal political, you know, it's been a wonderful experience for me. To work with a group of people who are so committed and love their country, and putting their hand up. You know, it's not easy being a member of parliament. So, and I think, you know, as a group, the commitment is there, and now's the time to put in the work.
Today we went to church, and when the service finished, my dad was like hurrying us up to bring him here to meet up with the rest of his senior citizens group. So they're here to support the fellow Tongan members that were here in the 70s. They were part of the Dawn Raid. My dad, he's not disabled, but he can't walk far distance. But to see him get off across the road to be here, it's, yeah, very emotional, but very good.
As a generation, we are so blessed to be able to live in this time where we can witness it live. I think generational curses and trauma does affect us, even though we don't see it directly. But even hearing stories of my uncle when they first moved to New Zealand and how they didn't know that, you know, things were done wrong to them, they just kind of accepted it. It was hard for me to hear as a young Tongan. So I think it's just a blessing that we get to be here to witness it and be part of the healing.
Are your family members here present today to be able to see them?
No, yeah, they're not. Some of them took it to the grave. So, but I'm glad I'm here. So I'll be standing along everyone else. And it's so beautiful seeing our Pacific community show up for today as well.
I know personally for me, I didn't really find out about the Dawn Raid until like probably late in my teenage years. So I think today's been a long time coming. It's only the first step to so much more to let our people heal.
I think I wanted my son to know that he was here. I wanted my wife to know, to be here, to support. I mean, it's a huge acknowledgement by the government. Yeah, I just wish they'd opened the doors. You know, like I think having a closed event is not our way. It's not what our communities do, you know? Like, why do you close it? Like, everyone should be allowed in and everyone's voices should be heard. I don't know. So it kind of, for me, it's better to be outside.
Today, I stand on behalf of the New Zealand government to offer a formal and unreserved apology to Pacific communities for the discriminatory implementation of the immigration laws of the 1970s that led to the events of the Dawn Raids.
I wish the government could go further, you know, to do the right to the wrongs that happened. You know, why don't they should have at least the opportunity for them to give an amnesty for overstayers, not just Pacifica people, but everybody who is currently an overstayer here. It would have been a very good, positive message. I know there are giving out findings and education, and that is really good because, you know, Dawn Raids should be taught in our schools and things. Because racism and discrimination is still happening, you know? It's an ongoing thing.
Hello, Olegeta. Welcome back to Tangata Pasifika. Today, it's all about the hashtag throwbacks, 2021 digital stories from our platform tpplus.co.nz. Right now, we're throwing it back to our Pacific Language celebrations.
That's right, Marama. Our Pacific Language Weeks are a great time to learn more about our brothers and sisters we share the Moana with. So right now, let's get to know more about the Solomon Islands.
Hello, Ketawan Talks, Nevlumi Dorin. I am currently studying civil engineering at Unitech and I am the student representative for the Solomon Islands community here in Auckland.
Hello, Olgeta. Me, Nevlumi, Wendy Andrews Mamata, and Miblo Renbel Province and Wagina Choiseul Province, Los Solomon Islands, and me happy to most for come today.
We want to be able to celebrate our language with everyone else and just share about ourselves, our country, and our culture. So in the Solomon Islands, we are not just one country, like one. Our country has 9 provinces and every province has their own languages, very, very different dialects. And so as a country, we communicate through Pidgin English. It's the one language that brings us together and you know, helps us to transfer information and all that stuff.
When I first came to New Zealand, I think it was 2019, we had like a cultural like event for like all the scholarship students. And then we had to like share our cultural like attire and cultural food. And I remember I represent like my province, Renville province. So I wore like cultural attire with traditional tattoos. Like, and then I had, and then I wore the best female cultural like attire. And then I, many people like ask me about like, oh, like I ask about my culture, and I had to like explain to them, and it's so nice just to share like my culture with like other people.
For people to be more aware of our country and our culture and our language, or just simply share with your one talks, your family and your friends. You know, our Solomon Islands music is pretty popular, so you know, go check out our music and just, you know, joining us and learning more and more about our culture and our country.
It's the story about my granddad, that he's been involved in the Second World War, and that is his name. And the flag master is my uncle, that he's been involved in giving away the information about the Japanese soldiers when they were occupied one of the islands in Martinique. This is like a a role model and attribute that will help the children to acknowledge the attributes of their ancestors. So writing this book is helping them to value and getting things that they learn from their family.
It's very interesting, and it shows it's a prehistoric story.
I wrote the books because in New Zealand we have no resources, and the writing these books is helping the Kiribati community to have resources available in the library and everywhere in the community. Otherwise, children won't learn their language and they won't be able to restore the language. As a lot of children in New Zealand, they have problems in learning their language because they've been immersed with the Palangi, the English language, and writing these books is to supporting them to read and write and learn to speak their language.
Ko tōku I ngā ko heo himo a Hili Manuele. Ko tōku lau e ko nā hoe he mea tā ua lele te noho nohonga tātou I tōku lau. He hoe. He hoe ke tauka vea te waka. Ke aloa loai, ke hano ki te utahe nua. Ia, ke hano hoki hoa ngota I te Moana, ko te Moana heau heau. Ke haka tauka vea te waka ke mawai he mahua e tuha mana hohuanga. Te tai uli tēnā e haka ngake mawai he pāo pāo. I vela ka hei o ka ngai te tai. Ko toke lau, ko te tai uli lawa e tāonga mo te taukawenga I lunga te waka hāngota, toko hanu hoki ki te utahe nua. Ko te hoi hoki, me tupu mai au, ma ki haka longa longa au, e hoi tautapa lawa ta mana toko mātua, te pone. Ko te pone la, ko te ata tēnei o te pone. Na tā ngai ki te hoi tēnei. Te pone te ia tātou I toke lau. Ko te ata la tēnei na tōi hoka tā hoka tuhe lama ki e te hoi tēnei. Te ata te Hat Valley. Tulo I wōna tō aino mana mātua. Ia, I te au koe, kou hui hui lahi ke vēna. Ni, ko hai pēnā ngā au inga, haka te tūpuranga tēnei e ki tātou. Ko me tā ua. Ki toke lau, ka veho ki tātou. Ka hea hea hua e, I lunga ta waka. Ko koe he pā, he tau rau o maha ua unga ki te mea, whanau koe I te pau pau. Ko koe tā hea, ai hea, he hea hea pē tangu ki hea, oi ki te mea ke pā I koe ki te koka hei nua I whanau koe ki ei. Ko te hoi hoki hoka tuhia ke tātou whanau.
Kia ora. Moana, welcome back to this look at our TP Plus archive of online pieces. What a year 2021 was for our people. So many stories to share from our thriving communities.
Coming up, we'll step back in time with Auckland Museum's Tamaki Heringa Waka exhibition. We'll also check out the award-winning artists helping their communities through their passion for music.
But first, let's go to Aotearoa, home of Fresh Gallery, the Scorpions, and recently, the new community hub, the Powerhouse.
It has been for a long time that a lot of youth in Aotearoa want a place of their own. And so having to create this space where a lot of our kids, our tamariki, can be a part of, and this is their place. This is about them. It feels complete. It's been empty for a while. And this is more like a piece of puzzle that has been missing, and it just fits right.
Service delivery, we've learned that we can't do anything without our community. So I think it's come about through really strong partnerships. We're excited that Sally Paya, who's the original cross power legend of this place in Aotearoa, is on our team. So this is just an extension of our current community, and we're excited that we get to do that and partner with other NGOs here in Aotearoa.
I want to give as much tools to our kids that I work with. As soon as they walk through that door, I want to be able to pass my knowledge as much as I can for them to be able to develop themselves so that they can be able to go further as far as they want to go in their education in the future.
The exhibition is Tamaki Heringa Waka. It tells multiple stories of tamaki, so from time, place, individuals, events, all kind of put together. So it's multiple perspectives. I take the approach that every story that I'm telling is a counter-narrative, that it's really important to me to tell stories that mitigate some of the deficit narratives, that tell a particular story about Pacific people's lives in tamaki and have done for a long time. So I'm trying to mitigate those things with the counter-narratives, the multiple types of stories, the biographies, first-person narratives, let people tell their own stories through different formats. TSMV Matua, which was one of the Union steamships that's associated with the Pacific diaspora. People feel very affectionate about the Matua, and there are three lives talked about within that. And there's the story of Keva Lowe, who was after the war, came over in 1946, and he's had his married father as well. Keva's story is told through the lives of descendants, and I think what I'd like people to be able to take away from that is generate conversations, intergenerational conversations about how did you come here, or how did your great-grandparents come here.
So Real Talks is a series that I came up with to bring more information and knowledge about music, the music industry, from people that are actually in the music industry, for people of any level. If you're up and coming, you may be retired in music and never knew about certain things. So it's just about coming together in an event for people to get more knowledge about the music industry. Here in the 312 Hub, we're going to be running workshops soon, so I thought of a way, if we can get people in to talk about music and get the conversation started, maybe I could like pick these people that want to do the workshops here. So that was a way of getting that, inspired me to get this Real Talk going.
One thing I definitely hope for in regards to the Real Talks program and the outcome that it brings is impacting young people who might not necessarily know that it's accessible to them. So by us providing them that opportunity and that platform to engage in real people who are in the music industry.
My name is James, and I'm the singer for Shepherd's Rain, Polynesian metal band from South Auckland. Right now we're here in Spring Hill Correction Facility. We were invited here to open up Samoan Language Week with the prisoners, to perform in front of them and share, you know, yeah, and getting to know them a bit. Well, I kind of used Samoan language into our music because I can speak the language. It's the language I was born with. And yeah, I'm just super proud.
It is important to recognise culture, and we recognise all the Pasifika language weeks, and it was a great way of recognising it here, with Shepherd's Rain coming in and kicking off Samoan Language Week with a very epic performance.
When I got here, there was no Pacific Island group. It was just a Kapahaka group. And I've always tried to connect with my culture and something that I always try to help out some of the other, you know, Pacific Islands, you know, to just to reconnect to the culture.
I'm pretty sure I've got the hair to join that band, but I don't think I have the musical talent.
Are you sure? I could see you there, girl. Well, if you missed out on any of these stories, tpplus.co.nz is where you'll find them. Tangata Pasifika will be back next week for another episode of our summer series. Until then, mudzoro kia.
Kia monuia.
People of the South, to our new homebound. Tangata Pasifika, born a people proud. People of the sun, our heritage grows on. Tangata Pasifika, keep our culture strong. People of the sun, our heritage grows on.